This is the test section of the world's largest refrigerated wind tunnel. It's the Icing Research Tunnel, the IRT. Right now, it's summer and 82 degrees outside the NASA Lewis Research Center in Cleveland, Ohio. But in here, we can simulate the frigid conditions necessary to study aircraft icing. The IRT has been making it safe to fly in icing conditions since near the end of World War II. During the war, the Army Air Corps performed a massive resupply effort of U.S. and Allied troops in Asia. Accomplishing this mission meant flying over the world's highest mountains, the Himalayas, in some of the worst icing conditions encountered by Allied forces during the war. An unacceptable number of supply planes were lost while flying the hump, not because of enemy fighters or ground fire, but due to icing. The Air Corps turned to the National Advisory Committee on Aeronautics, NASA's predecessor, for help. And the IRT was born. Since those early days, IRT has focused on three areas of icing study. One, conducting basic research on how aircraft icing takes place. Two, development and testing of de-icing and anti-icing systems. And three, certifying icing protection methods for commercial and military aircraft. Before we get into the details of how the IRT contributes to aircraft safety, here's how the wind tunnel works and what makes it unique. The spray bars are the heart of the IRT. Nozzles in the 8 bars produce supercooled droplets of water between 10 and 40 microns in diameter. That's about the size of a grain of pollen. In a real cloud, the average droplet is about 20 microns. The droplets from the spray bars aren't frozen. They turn into a form of water that's technically referred to as supercooled. This means the droplets going through the air are a liquid until they hit something. Then they instantly freeze, just as cloud droplets freeze when they strike cold aircraft components. This close simulation of natural clouds is what makes the IRT such a good test facility. Another unique aspect of the IRT is its cooler. It produces the low temperatures needed for year-round testing. A 2,100-ton cooler, one of the biggest in the world, provides more low-temperature air than 600 home air conditioners. The cooler was designed by Willis Carrier, the founder of the Carrier Air Conditioner Company. The wind in the tunnel comes from a 25-foot, 12-bladed fan. It can turn faster than 7.5 times per second. The wooden blades are made of laminated Sitka spruce. A 5,000-horsepower electric motor turns the fan with precise control. It can regulate the fan's speed to plus or minus 5 revolutions per minute over the range of 50 to 460 RPM. To defeat aircraft icing, researchers must first find out how ice forms. More than one type of ice forms on aircraft, and the IRT must be able to reproduce them. It's one thing to produce ice in an artificial environment, but quite another to make sure the simulation matches reality. Actual flights of Lewis Research aircraft through natural ice-producing conditions verify the IRT is on target. Researchers are taking simulations one step further with help from the IRT. They're developing computer models of how ice forms on aircraft. And are using tests in the IRT to verify how close these models come to reality. Understanding aircraft icing is the first step. The next step is how to prevent ice and get rid of ice once it forms. Pneumatic boot de-icing was an early development in the battle against ice. Other options were developed when the gas turbine engine, the jet, came into use. The jet engine is good at producing large quantities of hot air. Early commercial and military jet aircraft designers used hot engine air to prevent ice by piping the warm air to the parts of an airplane that are most vulnerable to icing. The aircraft industry thought icing problems were solved. Work in the IRT tapered off to the point where some thought it would be closed. But with the fuel crisis of the 1970s came the production of high-efficiency jet engines. It was no longer affordable to use hot engine air to battle ice. In the 1980s, aircraft makers turned to the IRT to test low-power de-icing methods, an example of which is electro-expulsive de-icing, where a shock wave traveling down the skin of a wing shatters accumulated ice. That and other low-power de-icing work continues today. Aircraft icing not only takes place in flight, but also on the ground. Snow and ice accumulating on aircraft surfaces can be a danger. The IRT is involved in researching methods of removing ice from aircraft on the ground awaiting takeoff. Along with the advent of jets came the wide use of helicopters. Ice is a danger to them. It quickly accumulates on the rotors, causing them to lose their lifting power. Helicopter icing research has found new use for the IRT. Keeping vertical liftoff aircraft like helicopters and the V-22 Osprey tilt-rotor aircraft safe and free of ice is one of the IRT's many contributions to modern aviation. The Icing Research Tunnel is also used extensively by the aircraft industry to certify that de-icing and anti-icing methods work. Both civilian airliners and military aircraft have used the IRT to verify the safety and effectiveness of their methods of fighting ice. The facility has saved industry millions of dollars as a lower-cost alternative to extensive flight testing. In 1986, the IRT was designated an International Historic Mechanical Engineering Landmark by the American Society of Mechanical Engineers. But that doesn't mean that it's a museum piece. Far from it. The NASA Lewis Research Center expects the IRT to contribute to aircraft safety well into the 21st century, where it will continue to freeze to please.